Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ipshita Zutshi. I'm from Birla Institute of Technology and Science, which lies in a relatively small village in the north of India. And it basically lies there because the founder of my institute, G.D. Birla, who is an eminent industrialist, was born there. And so by accident or by luck, the town of Pilani got my institute, and it's around 50 years old. And currently, I'm a third year undergraduate student there and pursuing a dual degree program for an MSc honors in biological sciences and a BE honors in computer science. So for the summer, I've been working at Professor Ronald Khalil's laboratory, and my work has been on nestin expressing cells in the third ventricle of the adult rat brain. To give you a brief outlook of what my presentation will be involving, I will first be talking about the third ventricle, because I realize some people may not be familiar with it, and the importance as to why I'm working with the third ventricle in the first place. I'll be talking about the expression of two proteins, nestin and vimentin, in cells of the third ventricle, and I'll also be then focusing on nestin expressing cells in the third ventricle and the possible functions this protein may be playing in these cells. So the third ventricle, firstly, what is it? It's a narrow channel passing through the basal forebrain, which is filled with cerebrospinal fluid. To give you a better idea of where the third ventricle exactly is located, so this that you see over here is a rat brain. And if we take a coronal section, that is, if you take a section like this, we get a rat brain section similar to this, and the third ventricle is located where you can see the star. So it's a hollow channel passing through the basal forebrain. And similarly, if you take a sagittal section, we can see how the third ventricle encompasses this entire area. Then it moves on to form the fourth ventricle and so on. So now that you have a better idea of exactly where the third ventricle is located, I'll talk about nestin. So the image you see over here is a normal progression of a stem cell towards a mature, differentiated neural cell. And the why nestin is so important is because it's been observed to be expressed at the progenitor cell level. It's a type 6 intermediate filament. And so why is this important to us? Because as nestin is expressed at the progenitor cell level, it is a marker of multi-lineage neural progenitor cells, and so its presence may indicate multipotentiality. So now, linking nestin and the third ventricle together, we see that there are nestin-expressing cells present all along the third ventricle. And these cells can be divided into two subclasses, the first being the ependymal cells. So over here, these are cell bodies stained with crescyl violet. And so these are the ependymal cells. And the hollow you can see over here is the third ventricle. And these ependymal cells are multiciliated, as we can see clearly. The cilia are projecting outwards into the third ventricle. And this image is stained for acetylated tubulin. And so we can see the cilia coming out of the cells. And the second subgroup of the nestin-expressing cells are the tanysites. Tanysites are modified ependymal cells. So this image has been stained for nestin. And so we can see the black cells are all tanysites. And what's interesting about them is that they have processes extending out of their cell body. And so these processes extend into the brain parenchyma. And they generally terminate at blood vessels, which I will be talking more about in detail later. So what is known on these nestin-expressing cells of the third ventricle? There have been several reports of neurogenesis by different groups on these cells of the third ventricle. But till now, all the data that we have is not conclusive, because these cells appear to be proliferating at a very low rate. So we're not so sure as to whether it's these nestin cells which are proliferating, or is there something else that actually is proliferating. and several groups observed slight proliferation, but with no co-localization witnessed. So, till date, there is no convincing correlation between nesting and proliferation in cells of the third ventricle, which is why I moved on to approach vimentin. So, vimentin is another protein which is expressed in most primitive cell types. And it's interesting because vimentin has been linked with nesting expression. So, it's been observed that vimentin is necessary for nesting assembly, and conversely, nesting is necessary for vimentin disassembly. So what this complicated mechanism seems to imply is that somehow nesting and vimentin link, nesting and vimentin expression is linked. And so that is why we started observing for vimentin also in the third ventricle. Given the necessary background, I'd like to state out what my objectives were. So my project was a two-fold approach. Firstly, as nesting appears to have no major correlation with proliferation, is it possible that other intermediate filaments such as vimentin are associated with cell division? And secondly, if nesting expressing cells are not normally proliferating, then what are they doing and why is nesting present in the third ventricle in the first place? So to go about my project, I observed the expression pattern of vimentin. And I also mapped nesting expressing cells along the third ventricle to identify regions around the NEC or nesting expressing cells to suggest nesting's functions. So when I first started out in the lab, my PI asked me a question, and I found it awkward then, but I really understand what he meant by it now. So he had asked me whether I know how to cook. And considering I did a whole lot of chromogenic immunohistochemistry, I now understand what he meant by it. So I stained for acetylated tubulin, for GFAP, for vimentin, and for nestin. Specifically because, as I talked about, the second part of my project, which entails mapping the entire nestin expression along the third ventricle, I used a microscope projector, and I traced out the outline of the third ventricle, on which I then located the nestin positive cells, scanned it into a computer, and with the series of images that I got for each section, I stacked all of them using a software by ImageJ, and generated a 3D projection using V3D. So coming to my results, this shows the staining pattern of vimentin. And when we stained for vimentin, we observed that several cells in the dorsal end of the first 0.8 millimeters. So if you remember the image of the third ventricle that I showed you, there's the rostral side, which is the front portion, and there's the caudal side, which is the back portion. And so in the first 0.8 millimeters and the last 2.1 millimeters, we could see several cells which were vimentin negative. Now to explain what I mean by vimentin negative, so this is the third ventricle, again. These are cell bodies stained for Kressel violet. So the purple cells that you see are vimentin negative, whereas the brown cells that you see are all vimentin positive. And so we can see a clear pocket of cells which are vimentin negative. And we also observed that most tanysites stained for nestin, as again we can see the third ventricle here and the tanysite processes extending outwards from the third ventricle. So what does this tell us? This told us that there may be a link between vimentin and nestin, we're not sure. But there may be, because they both do stain for the tanysites. And so currently this research is preliminary, we haven't got convincing reports yet. But we did a double stain for vimentin and nestin. And so in green, you can see the vimentin over here. And for example, this would be a clear-cut vimentin positive cell. And as you can see, several more all along this ventricular wall. And so when the same image was scanned using a confocal microscope in red, where we can see the nestin, we again observed a few more cells positive for nestin, much lesser than vimentin, but they were there. And so when we performed a merge of the green and the red, overlap of any green and red would result in a yellow image, which interestingly in the merge we can see several yellow cells all along the third ventricle wall. Now, what we can infer from this is that while Neston seems to be co-localizing with Bimentin, there are several cells which seem to be only Bimentin positive. And right now it's too preliminary to state that there is a clear link in their expressions, but it is likely that there are several other proteins which are acting as factors promoting the expression of Neston and Bimentin. But it also states that Bimentin possibly could be involved in the proliferation. We don't know yet, but it's worth looking at. So coming to the second part of my project, which is the staining pattern of Neston expressing cells. The images you can see here are for Neston. So the dark images are for Neston. And along the 3.5 millimeter extent of the third ventricle, in the first 0.8 millimeters in figures A and C, we can see the Neston positive ependymal cells and the tanysites. We saw rare expression all along the middle 0.6 millimeters. And again, in the last 2.1 millimeters, there was dense tanysite staining. And there was a bit of a problem that we faced over here, because due to the dense tanysite staining, the most of the ventricular wall was obscured, due to which we couldn't quite make out whether there are any ependymal cells lying underneath. So that might be one shortcoming. So given the sections, I then prepared the 3D projection of the third ventricle. So each of these are single sections of the brain all compiled together. So in yellow is the ependymal cell, in white are the tanysites. All these are Neston positive ependymal cells. And I'd just like to play this for you. It shows you the same thing, but it looks fancy. So for a better image, there's one very clear cut observation that we can make from this image, and that is that the Neston expression is clearly localized to two regions along the third ventricle, and it seems to not be occurring in the remaining areas, which suggests that Neston does have a function, which is why it's being so specifically expressed in certain areas. So we took a look around at the neighboring regions along the third ventricle, and we observed that these regions include the median preoptic nucleus, the subfornical organ, the median eminence. Basically, there is something very common linking these areas together, and that is that all these regions are circumventricular organs. Now, what are circumventricular organs? These organs have an incomplete blood-brain barrier, which makes them instrumental in the transport of hormones from the brain to the blood. So what this tells you is that you have Neston. You have Neston expressing cells, and somehow they always seem to co-localize in CVO regions. So is there a link? Because this seems to suggest that there is some sort of underlying factor. And this is not surprising apparently, because tanysites and CVOs do have an inherent link. Tanysites are involved in hormonal transport from the cerebrospinal fluid to the blood, and are also speculated to secrete GnRH. So tanysites being localized to CVO regions, for that matter, is not surprising at all. What is surprising is that all tanysites express Neston. And that means that Neston, which is an intermediate filament, could possibly be involved in the specialized transport functions of tanysites. And it's also possible that as tanysites secrete gonadotropin-releasing hormone, and the amount of hormone secreted into the body has to keep varying according to different conditions due to puberty, due to different stages of development. Neston may be involved in such plasticity and modeling also required to regulate the amount of hormones that are released. So to summarize all that I found out, the role of Bimentin and its possible link with Neston and proliferation, we're still too early in the studies to make a clear-cut assumption.